So thank you to the organizers, to the audience, to be courageous enough to attend the course. I will put on my webpage the contents of each course, not everything in one time. So tomorrow or Monday, you will find what I will say today on the same after. So if you miss some points, you can look. So I give three courses, and then Kashiwara gives three courses. And it's there is a my courses will be more or less like that. I will speak of Indsheaves, and also a subcategory, the subanalytic sheaves. Then, in order to define the Indsheaf or subanalytic sheaf of temperate holomorphic function on the operation and on it, and then I will explain the regular Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. So that's me. Regular. But I will follow, because the way I will treat regular is very parallel, almost the same as irregular. Okay? So I will not recall the Kashiwara's proof of regular of this theorem, but I will explain it with in the language of Indsheaves what we need. And after, Kashiwara will do the same with E, which means enhanced. So enhanced Indsheaves, OE, which is enhanced version of OT, and irregular, general, Riemann-Hilbert, but with this enhanced setting. Okay. That's why we organize the talk like that. Okay. And I think it's good to have the first three talks to understand the structure of the proofs. Okay. That's all. So I think I could do, but I think it's a bad thing to give a history on the subject. I will write a few lines of history, but it's always it's not to the people who do something to write the history. It's dangerous. So maybe I skip this. And I prefer to start directly, but maybe, so in my notes you will find all the bibliographical reference, okay? In particular about Indsheaves. Maybe Indsheaves, this is done in asterisk. The theory of Indsheaves is developed with all details in this booklet. Okay. So, one. Okay. So, okay, I say I don't do history, but I do a little. A little history, not so much. Okay. So in 75, Kashiwara constructed, shows that the functor of solution are going from holonomic d-module to construct the functor, shows that the functor of solution is well defined with value in constructible sheaves. Okay, so it's a very important result. And at the same time, people don't know that. I can say that because he's not here. He would be shy. But he gave he gave the condition of perversity. Okay. He, of course, the word didn't exist at this time, but he gave the condition which are called perversity. Okay. And of course, he asked the question, what about the regular case?
Okay. Did he define regular singularities at that time?
No, he defined that in 77 in some footnote of Ramis. It's written by Ramis in some, I don't want to make too much history. Anyway, what he did in 80 is very close to what I will explain now. It's at the starting point of what I will do now. He defined what is called the functor theorem. Theorem with value in OX, let's say. On here, you've put F, which is R constructible. So it's a functor from R constructible sheaves to D modules. And he proved, so I say I will not do, but I give my version of Riemann-Hilbert. So always, qu'est-ce que tu auras? This is published by École Polytechnique. It's a seminar, written seminar of École Polytechnique. And he proved the Riemann-Hilbert correspondence at this time. And the paper was published in 84. And at the 84 also, there is another proof by Mepkut. I don't try. And that's for the regular case. And then came the much later in, I don't remember, around 2000, I don't know exactly, around 12 or something like that, came the work of Mochizuki. But before that, there were some work by Saba, and after Mochizuki, there was some work by Kedlaya for the analytic case. So with this work, you understand more or less how it works for irregular. But then Kashiwara and Daniolo Kashiwara, I think in 2013, gave a big theorem of reconstruction. They call it Riemann-Hilbert, but I think it's not Riemann-Hilbert. I will say it's a reconstruction theorem. Anyway, so that on the tool was this enhanced Indsheaves that Kashiwara will explain. Okay, so that's
it's important, but it's T Mochizuki, it's Takoro Mochizuki.
Yeah, I don't know which one. The young one. Okay. So I will speak of. So today I hope to explain you the theory of Indsheaves, subanalytic sheaves, and to give a few examples. Okay, of course, in this course, I assume that people are familiar with the six operations and the old fashioned theory, which is called Dirac categories. Okay, I don't use Lurie and so things like that. So, what is an IND object? So, when you have a category, so of course, we work in a given universe, U, and when necessary, but it's not our subject, we don't need to change universe, okay? Except when you have C, you denote by C wedge the functor from C up to set. So this is not in the universe anymore. And inside, you have the category of Indsheaves and object, excuse me, and C. So what is an IND object? X is in NC if you can represent it by an inductive limit where xi is in C, but the inductive limit is taken in C wedge, of course. Okay, because C has no limit a priori. Okay, and you ask that I, the category on which you take the limit, is small and I don't know, I use the name filtrant, maybe it's not the, we use that always, okay. Anyway, that's basic. Okay. So that's the theory of ind object, which is well known since Gotendick. And we will be interested in the case where, so I don't give the theory of ind object, I will explain Indsheaves. Okay. So we will be interested when C is abelian. In this case, and C is also abelian. And what can we say? So there are a lot of classical things. C in NC is exact, fully faithful. What else? There are a lot of results, but I choose what I, okay. So NC admits limit, young people say co-limit, I say inductive limit, and this is the same limit, or it's commute, these limits commute with NC to C wedge, okay? But and by construction more or less, you have this formula, ohm in NC of, I don't know which notation take, F, Y, and lim of Xi is isomorphic to the limit, usual in set, or in group, of C, Y, Xi, but here you assume, of course, Y is in C, not in NC. Okay, so you see this formula classically. If you delete the quote, it's totally false. Okay, that's the main point of ind object.
And also there is the axiom ab 5 that is exact.
Yeah, of course, in this category, small filtrant inductive limits are exact. Okay, I don't give all properties, because it will take the whole hour, okay? But I will give examples which are more interesting than the theory. So the main point is the following, the danger. If assume that C admits inductive limit, okay? Then the functor C to and C does not commute with such limit. Okay? It does not commute because of this formula, which is false in the category C. Okay? If you delete this is false. Okay? It's not the same limit. Okay? So I propose to give a short, to take examples in dimension zero. So let's do Indsheaves over one point. Okay, that is. So I take a. So it's an example, so it's not a theory. So I take K, a field, for short. Okay? And what else? So mod K is a category of K modules or K vector spaces. And also I use mod FK, which means finite dimensional. Okay. Uh, And I will denote for short, it will be the my notation after, I of k, the category of end object of mod k. So, of course, you have a functor for mod k to I k. And if you have a vector space, it is an inductive limit, a vector space. Okay, but you have two functors going by. So this one is iota, and I have alpha and beta that I will describe now. Okay, alpha of a inductive limit in quote of xi is a usual inductive limit of xi. And beta, let's say beta, one way is like that. So V is a, excuse me, no, beta, what is that? It's the contrary. Alpha, beta, beta, excuse me, like that. Beta goes from sheaves to end sheaves. Okay? And beta v is the inductive limit for w contained in v and w finite dimensional of w. So you can check that these functors are adjoint. So what is right and left? I've not written it. Okay, we will come back for sheaves later on this. So another way to define beta is that beta of V applied to W is ohm W K tensor V. It's a contravariant functor on W. Okay. So, and I want to show you some surprising things with these functors. For example, take V infinite, not finite. Okay. So, and look, so you have a beta of V goes to V. There is a, and it's an epimorphism. So let's denote by N the kernel. So if I calculate ohm K beta of V, I find the inductive limit.
Is it epimorphism in which the
category is? I of V.
It has
the first embedding I, which
is. I is embedding, yeah. Yeah, I don't write I.
Just only.
Yeah.
No, but why it isn't? It is not.
It's a different category, so sure.
No, yeah. But why is it? Why is it an epimorphism in the category in? No. Because beta V is like the name of W, then you have limb of trivial limb, so the co-kernel is limb of W, of limb of W, which is a non-trivial inductive system. I think it's injective and not so.
No, no, it's not. No, no. No, no, it's not. It's like that, I'm sure. It's objective. So I want to show you that if I take the kernel, I find something which I test the kernel to k, okay? So I will find ohm k w. So I find v, okay? And of course, ohm k v is v. So you have an example of an end object such that ohm over k n is zero on n is not zero. So if you want, you have a sheaf which is zero on every open set. There are not so many open sets. Okay, there is two open sets, empty set on the whole space, one point. And when you take the value,
and I think you can make a mistake. I think it's inclusion, but implication, because holomorphic to be a sheaf is morphism of finite rank according to.
Maybe you are right. I don't know. Okay. Anyway, if it's the contrary, it doesn't change.
I think it's co-kernels.
Okay. So it doesn't. Anyway.
It's still true that it is still true that whatever you say is it is still true that one from K to this is
you
is it's because of using the formula that you have written.
Yeah, you are right. The limit is exact.
Come to be of free, it's our usual linear maps is finite rank, yeah?
Yeah.
So it's part of all maps. Yeah.
Okay, you are right, it was a mistake. Okay, so anyway, nevertheless, you have an example of an IND object, yes, which is zero, like that, and which is not zero, of course. And another thing which is a little strange. Is the following. If you take the end object of the finite dimensional vector space, let's call it for short IFK, then it's more or less obvious that you have an equivalence of category by the functor alpha, which alpha, I remember, sends inductive limit with quote to the usual inductive limit, and this is an equivalence of category. Okay. As well as, for example, the category set of sets is the category of end object of finite sets. Okay. It's an equivalence, but you can send them both in IK. By iota, and here by obvious functor. So what is dangerous? It does not commute. It does not commute because the inductive limits here and here are not the same. Okay. 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 So it was a few examples, not to discourage you, but just to tell you that the theory can be subtle. And yeah, another thing. Which is a little depressing. Another thing is that the category and it was my of mod k, what I call ik, the category has not enough injectives. Okay. So this is in our book on category on sheaves with Schapira, but I must say that the proof is very, very difficult, too difficult for me. But it's a result. Okay. But there is something which is.
So no, whenever you put a restriction on the modulus, like if you take modulus of some bounded. On the dimension, then by Grothendieck result, it has enough injection.
No, but here.
Okay, here there is no bound, so it's okay. I think it should. Well,
no. If you have fixed the universe, there are not enough injectives. Of course, if you change the universe, then you can. Okay. So, but there is a notion which a substitute to injective, just which is a notion of quasi injective in. And C, so C is abelian. So you say that A is quasi-injective if om of NC dot A is exact on C. Not on NC, but on C. And in practice, quasi-injective is enough for many purposes. Okay, so I don't say more. Okay.
Then you can construct those things.
Yeah, it's useful, but it's okay. But the theory is difficult. When you want to derive, it's maybe with the language of infinity category, it's easy now. But at this time, it was not easy. Okay. Anyway, so let's pass to. So now you know everything on sheaves in dimension zero. So now we'll define sheaves in any topological space.
So the result is that there are under mild conditions that are always quasi-injective.
No, yeah. If C is a Grothendieck category, then there are enough quasi-injective. That's the theorem. If C is a Grothendieck category, okay, and C is not a Grothendieck category, but it has enough quasi-injective. Okay, don't worry so much with all these things because I will speak both of sheaves and also subanalytic sheaves. And subanalytic sheaves are much easier to manipulate. Okay. So, in all these talk, M will be what we call a good topological space, which means it's locally compact. So it's not for algebraists. It's Hausdorff. It's a countable infinity. And also finite, flabby, or injective, I don't know, dimension. Anyway, we will work over a field, so it doesn't change. Okay. Okay. And I fix K, a field. After we will use a sheaf of rings, or sheaf of K algebra. Okay. And most of what I will say can be extended to by taking unital commutative rings with good properties. Okay. But it's not the subject. Okay. So I assume that. So yeah, my notation mod Km. So the sheaves of K modules on M. On the derived, as far as possible, we use a bounded derived category, but sometimes it's no more possible. So that's our notation, okay, the derived category. And I don't, just one notation maybe, not all notation. If A, or let's say Z, is locally closed in X, in M, excuse me, I always use a constant sheaf KZ, which is a constant sheaf with talk K and Z. And okay. Okay, so I don't say more on the classical theory of sheaves, on the six operation and so on. So what is a sheaf? So for short, I denote it IKM, so it's the end object of, so it's not what I'm writing now, it's not the end object of sheaves, in the end object of sheaves with compact support. So of course, over one point, it was not it was the same. But so why do we take the end object of sheaves with compact support? Because there is a theorem that if you take U gives I K U for U open in M, this pre-stack is a stack. So we denote it I. Not the same I script I Km. Okay. And if you don't take the end object of the category with compact support, it will not be a stack. It's easy to have counterexample. So for those.
How do you restrict an end object to smaller open if you have only sheaves with.
I don't remember.
You know, because the sheaf is compact support on U, then it doesn't restrict the sheaf is compact support on.
You can cut by an open set, smaller open set. It will have compact support. If F something like that, I guess. To be honest, I forgot. But it seems reasonable, no?
You just take extension by zero from of course, yes. Okay. Something like this.
Honestly, I forgot. But it's a general for stacks, no? For unstacks, you can do that. At this level, you don't need sheaves. Okay. I don't swear it's true. You have to check. okay, so it's interesting to make the comparison. For I'm sure there are a lot of analysts in this in the assistance. So the comparison with analysis, if you take distribution on M, it's not the dual of C infinity on M, but it's the dual of the infinity function with compact support. Okay. And in the object is a little like taking the dual. Okay. And that's the reason why distribution are a sheaf, gives a sheaf, and why unsheaves give a stack. Okay, so we have a stack, and we have many operations on the stack. So maybe I will take my time. So I recall IKM is the end object, category of end object of category of sheaves with compact support. Okay. So we have many operations again from mod Km to I Km. As before, on so I describe this operation. What is IM of F? So you take, inductive limit. I've not written it. For U relatively compact in M of F U. Okay. What is alpha of a inductive limit in quote of Fi? It's the usual inductive limit of Fi. And what is beta? Beta is more difficult to explain, but as an object of C wedge, as a functor, recall that this is contained in the category of functor of mod C K M up to mod of Z or set as you want. So if I take it, I calculate it on G, it will be H zero of R gamma M. The dual of G, that is G Km tensor F.
Okay. So it should sound dual.
So it's kind of wrong. It's contravariant on one set.
Yeah, it's contravariant.
IHES, you're right.
But the idea is that since you have a limit of things, it's compact.
Okay, I don't give. You have to prove that it's in the object. Okay, I give a short way to define it. Okay, maybe it's not the best definition,
it's
but
not the compact support.
Yeah, G has compact support. No, in the object is a functor, is in particular a functor on the category of sheaves with compact support. Okay. You have to think of and sheaves as follow: a sheaf is a functor on the category of open sets. Okay? But now we take functors on category of sheaves, or sheaves with compact support. Okay? So it may happen that there are n sheaves which are zero on each open set without being zero, as we have seen an example. Because now the category of n sheaves is much bigger than the category of sheaves. That's why it's interesting. Okay, so what I wanted to say, So
this notation looks too complicated because you are just doing H0 of this coefficient in the sheaf. R ohm, why R gamma? Because everything is positive. Ohm is a non-negative degree tensor.
Yeah, okay.
So it should be just H0.
Yeah, you are right. Bad habits of derived category. Okay. I will describe this functor beta in a moment. Okay. So there are adjunction. Where are they? My adjunction formulas. I have to recall. So I have. Iota. Where I put my adjunctions? You have a pair of adjunct functors like that. So they are adjuncts. Moreover, iota m and beta m are exact. And what else? They are all exact, excuse me. But those ones are fully faithful. And of course, alpha m is exact. Okay. And you can deduce the commutation with limits from the adjunction, of course, as usual. Okay. So now I will define the operations. So first, the internal operation. So maybe you will protest because it's not canonical, but nevertheless. If f is like that, g is like that, j, inductive limit of fi, then you can define the tensor product as the inductive limit for I j of fi tensor j gj. On the I ohm, which is not ohm, Fg as. So we have inductive limit here, inductive limit here. We first take off this one. So we find projective limit. So this is always true. So of ohm Fi. Inductive limit of JJ, and this is projective limit in I, inductive limit with quote of ohm Fi JJ.
So
So here it's, I define that. Okay.
As an inshift, you mean?
So this is an inshift, clearly, on here too.
It's home as a sheaf, yes.
Here, there are usual sheaves, okay? Home is fully faithful.
Home is the home sheaf or home functor?
It's the same. Excuse me, home sheaf. Yeah. It was badly written. On here too.
And when you take a limb over I, this would be in so which category?
And sheaves.
Do they have inverse limits?
Yeah. They have. Yes, they have.
This is one of the properties that you...
I don't give an exhaustive course on sheaves. I just give a few formulas, and I will insist on the formula which are strange, which are not the classical one. Okay. And there is another home without I, because.
And the inverse limits are computed in zero.
In what?
The inverse limits are in zero for in.
Inverse limit is, does not change. Huh? It's the inductive limit which is dangerous. Projective limit is okay. And if you remember, I told you that I. Km was a stack. So a stack has an internal home. Okay. So what is the link with home of the stack? Let's see. Km, then this is alpha composed with I home. Okay, so we have one new operation, which is I ohm. So it's no more the six operation, because we will have four others. Okay, so maybe. Okay, so now the external operations. When we have a continuous map, F, from M to N, so we have the inverse. So we keep the same notations when the functors that we define commute with iota. Okay, so but we change the notation. If the functor does not commute, so if it is an extension of the classical functor, we keep the same notation. So we can define f minus 1 of inductive limit with quote of jj. Okay, so jj. By taking the inductive limit of f minus 1 jj. Okay. So you will say this is not compactly support, but it is a sheaf. Okay. And, we know that mod km, I don't write iota, is contained in I km.
Can you explain just a moment? I didn't quite understand. So you write this formula, alpha m composed, on the previous blackboard. Yeah. Alpha m composed is this.
Yeah, okay, maybe I write.
Well, so this is an in, this is an in the.
So let me write it. You have.
I don't see any category there.
Yeah.
So you have from IKM up cross IKM to IKM. This is IOM. And then mod km.
Mod km, so this is the usual shift.
Usual home. Yeah, that's the one.
And this is the shape of homomorphisms in the stack. This is the idea.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
What I said, yeah. The morphism of the stack. Okay. So, I'm surprised that you don't protest that this is not well defined, because I choose a inductive limit, so we should, it's not very intrinsic as a definition, but it works.
Can you take also compact sets in the...
No, we don't care that it's not compact, supported, because these are sheaves, okay? And sheaves are contained in unsheaves.
Ah, but we previously explained that it was...
By your term, that I didn't write. So I take the inductive limit, it's perfectly defined. Okay. So now I forget compact support. When I have a sheaf, I look at it as an unsheaf. And I can say that an unsheaf is the inductive limit also of sheaves. It's not the definition. So...
But the result is still in the FKL?
Please.
The result is still in the category.
It's a unsheaf. What do you want?
Everyone is a
sheaf. This is a usual sheaf. When I take the inductive limit, it is an unsheaf. So the direct image, so there are. So I give the formula which. It's a little, maybe I'm not obliged to give a formula, because if I tell you it exists and it is adjoint of f minus 1, it's enough. But I give the formula. So you cut fi by a compact set k, take the inductive limit, and after you take the projective limit, not before. Okay. So with this definition, you can see that you have a pair of adjoint functors. So what is more interesting is a proper direct image, because it will be different. What is, so since it's different, it does not commute with iota, we denote it by a double schrick. So what is a proper direct image of a So maybe, yeah, I make a parenthesis. What is the direct image, proper? Usually, what is a direct image with proper support of F? It is inductive limit for U relatively compact in M of the direct image of F U. That's one definition, which is better than to say I take proper support and so on. Okay? So here, we take the same definition. So I assume that Fi have compact support. So it's the same definition. So what do I change the notation? I change the notation because inductive limits are not the same. Okay? So this functor does not commute with iota. It's not the same limit with the functor. Okay, so maybe I will write a...
Ah, because you can have on the compact, yeah, many things above, because it's
yeah, does not come in. Okay, so let's maybe I summarize all my results, because I'm afraid that some people may be lost. So I summarize my result. Okay, let's make a big step, and we pass to the derived categories. Okay, so you have to believe me, because I don't prove anything on the derived functor. So I go to the bounded, when it's possible, derived category. So now I derive an exact functor. It's not difficult. Iota m, alpha m. So it was exact, so there is no problem. Beta m. And after I will give a few results of commutation. Tensor product, I am over a field.
Alpha goes to usual shift. Huh? Alpha goes to
Starbuck.
Yeah. No, it goes to usual shift.
Okay. Or you can replace B by other. Okay. Okay, so this is IHOM. So this one, we don't know if it is bounded or not. Yeah, maybe. OK, I don't write. It's too much work. So let's write f minus 1, this one. And also, the proper direct image admits a right adjoint with the same notation, because it commutes with iota. And I'll make a short tableau. Here I write my functor, f minus 1, f star, or maybe derive, I don't know. Okay, so it means it commutes. Okay, so it's a little boring, I'm sorry. So let's do something more interesting.
When you are working with this, so in particular you have the classical X groups in a given category, but if you have a category like this, which is too large, then you don't, in general, one doesn't know that the X groups are smaller, and it could be.
But in practice, I tell you, I will skip to subanalytic sheaves, but in practice, we will use Indsheaves mainly in this situation. We will look at R IHOM, for example, of F G, where this one is a usual sheaf. In practice, it will be like that. Very rarely, or maybe never, we use IHOM for both Indsheaves.
And then you can use quasi-injective.
Zero means it's commuting cross dust. Zero
means commute. Dot does not commute. Okay, but unfortunately, we are obliged to work with sheaf of rings, because I want to apply all this theory to d modules. Okay.
So when you in the table zero is
commute. Cross does not. But I will give you notes, don't worry. Okay, so in practice, I will have something like that. A is a sheaf of KM algebras. And for example, M is in IKM. So what does it mean that M is an A module? So it means that you have a morphism of sheaf of rings, and maybe I will write om of in IKM. Of M, M. Okay. But this is alpha of I ohm. M, M. Okay. So it's the same as to have a map from beta by adjunction, beta A, to I ohm, M, M. Okay. So there are two points of view that we confuse. Maybe it makes things maybe difficult to follow. We define IA is a category, abelian category of A modules in IKM, okay? So in a module is the data of a morphism of algebra, or maybe it's better to write this like N. You have a morphism of algebra from A to the endomorphism of M, okay?
Usual sheaf.
No, as an end sheaf. This is a usual sheaf.
Yeah, okay. The usual sheaf of endomorphism.
Which is alpha. So ohm is alpha I ohm. And beta alpha are adjunct. Okay. So if I write alpha I ohm, I put alpha here, so I have a morphism from beta A here. Okay. So, but beta A is no more a sheaf, it's an end sheaf, okay? So you have to look at beta A as a ring object in the category of end sheaves, okay? So beta A is a ring object in IKM. So you have the choice, but it's equivalent. So you can take the category mod. So you can define what is a module in the tensor category, and you can define mod beta A, and it's equivalent to what we call I A, which are A modules in IKM.
What happens if you consider sheaves of A modules instead of sheaves of K modules?
No, we can do also, but that's another story. So I don't want to, it's a little confusing, so I don't want to confuse more because we shall not use it, okay? Of course, we can define the end sheaves of the category of A module with compact support, end object of the category of A module with compact support.
Is it the same thing?
No, it's not the same, no.
Ah, not the
same. No. So I prefer to skip this. It's dangerous, okay? So in... So, and I want to give a formula which is totally not usual.
and it's different if I change even field, or just extension of field, if I do just extension of fields.
Yeah, but A is a, where you see a field. A is a sheaf of rings.
Yeah, but I can just take, in some sense, if I just take stupid thing, take constant sheaf of rings.
Yeah.
Is it the same or not?
If you take A equal Km, then you find...
No, A is a ring, the usual ring, and take the constant sheaf of rings A.
Yeah. Yeah. So what happened?
Then is the category of n things on that is the same as this?
Yeah, I don't know. If you take A equal Km...
The trivial thing, it should be
for A, yeah, for A equal
Km, it's okay. That's why... If A equal Km, IA is IKM. Okay.
And if A is a constant.
Okay.
Ah.
Well,
anyway.
Yeah. Anyway, it's sufficiently complicated. It's not necessary to add other questions that we don't need in this story. Here. Yeah. No, but we shall use it only for with D on the constant on C. In practice, it will be Cm on Cx or dx. Okay. Okay. So there are a lot of formulas, and I think I have no time to develop. But because this notation will appear during all the talk, so I need to spend a little more time. So we shall use dBIA. So if m, so if m is in here, we'll use where is that? For example, we will have such notation where k also is in dB I A. Then this notation will be the same as I ohm over beta A, beta M K. And similarly, if N is in dB I A up, then N tensor A K will be the same as beta n tensor beta a k. Depending if you look at things here or here. Okay. So it's a little confusing and I prefer not to insist. Okay. So what is a strange formula which will be very useful and which has no counterpart?
So m here is what? M up.
It's written, it's an object of the Dirac category of IA.
It's really an and or two. It means because you'd like to apply beta of m, suppose.
Yeah, you can. M is also an object of IKM. So it's what I said. You can look at it. You have m, which is dB I K M, okay? But you can also look at it with an action of A in the endomorphism of M. Okay, so you can look at, or maybe, okay, if you don't like, you put beta everywhere, but as we did before. In asterisk, it's not so important. I want to give a very strange formula. You will not believe, but it's true. So we have A as above, sheaf of K algebras, and F is a usual sheaf.
Why did you write the I A O? In the, what was the reason to?
Because it's right and left.
Non-commutativity, not the opposite category.
No, up is inside. Huh? It's right and left. We work with D-module, it's not commutative.
Yeah, but also, in this tensor form, you don't put beta of k?
No.
I think you should, because beta of m.
No, it's not. No. Not beta, no.
I understand, k and m are elements of the same category, yeah?
Yes, this is my problem.
Okay.
I think M should be in a smaller pattern.
Oh, no. Yeah, I see you. Okay. So it's a beta A module, but it's not beta K. So it's not beta A, certainly not. Wait, encore 2 minutes. Alors. So I will finish this, but with a formula that looks strange. So I take K in dB IA up on L in dB A, not IA. Then I have this formula, R I om F K, tensor as you want, with beta or not beta, maybe I write beta L. I om F K is right, K tensor beta A beta L. But with this notation you can also write the same without beta as you want. So, if you want things, it's a question of notation. But it's a little confusing. Okay, so that's very strange. You can put inside R om when you have beta. Okay. And maybe just to explain you what is beta, to give you, and after I stop, let's come back to the beginning. What is beta of KU? Where is that? So it will be inductive limit. So U is open for V relatively compact in U of KV. And when S is closed, beta Ks is the inductive limit for V contain S of K closure of V. Okay. And to prove this formula, in fact, one reduces to the case where L is something like Ku. And then there is some work. Or AU. Okay, so I stop 3-5 minutes. Okay. So after this, next hour I will speak of the subanalytic topology, which is much easier, on the link with Indsheaves.
What is the, can you what I didn't quite get the notation before the home. What is it, like a T underlined or what? What is the letter I? I, kind of an I.
Script, I don't know. Okay, 5 minutes. So now I will speak of subanalytic sheaves. So M, let's say real analytic manifold, or more generally, analytic space, okay? A subanalytic space, more generally, subanalytic space. And so all these things I should have said, or I have said maybe, are due to Schapira and myself, this part. So that's an idea that I explain to the analyst all the time, but they don't understand that in analysis there are too many open sets, very bad open sets that you cannot do anything with, and it's better to restrict to a good family of open sets, and then we take op. So you have op M is a category of open subsets, but it's better to look at the category of subanalytic, so it will be subanalytic open subsets, and it's convenient, but to take relatively compact. So it's okay. There are two approaches. You can take relatively compact or not relatively compact. But for what I will say, it's enough. So it's a precite, it's a category, by inclusion, of course. And I will put a Grothendieck topology, very simple. M S A is a site such that the object are the subanalytic, relatively compact sets. And the covering are the finite covering. To say that a covering is finite doesn't mean it is finite, strictly speaking. It means you can extract a finite covering. Okay. You have a covering, ui, if there exists j in I, j finite, such that u is a union of uj. That's why I call a finite covering. Okay. So it's a very easy thing. It's a Grothendieck topology. You can check the axioms. Yeah.
But then the points that you have are not conservative.
The point, we don't care. Who cares of the points?
Because some moves are simpler when you have points.
Yeah, when you teach sheaf theory in the first year at university, it's better to have points.
Of a flat sheaf is flat. If you don't have points, then you will get.
But it's locally coherent or not?
Is what?
The topos is locally coherent still, no?
I have no idea.
Ah, because of the finite covering, so it has enough points.
It should be.
Yes, okay. But
they may come from something.
No, but I know there are people working on that, and you can add points to M. More or less, you take the boundary of all open subsets, and then you have a.
But also, there's something called O-minimal things, it's very.
Yeah, of course. Subanalytic, I like subanalytic, but you can say exactly the same thing with O-minimal. The only point is I'm not familiar with O-minimal. But you can extend the theory to O minimal without any problem. Okay. So of course, you have a morphism of sight from M, the usual topological space, to the subanalytic sight, okay? Because there are less open set here and less covering. Okay. So you have this. Okay. So you have a pair of adjoint pointers. Okay. As usual for sheaf theory. And also, there is also the another rho minus 1 admits a left adjoint that which is easy to describe. And after I will make the link with Indsheaves, of course, but wait. This, maybe I don't write M always, this is a sheaf on M subanalytic associated with U gives F of the closure of U. So we have these functors which are, alors, take care, the direct image, maybe I skip M in the notation, when there is no rho star, is left exact, of course, but not right exact in general. On beta, of course, rho minus 1 is exact. It admits adjoint right and left. And the lower shriek rho is exact. Okay. And how to recognize that a pre-sheaf is a sheaf on the subanalytic site? There is a very nice criterion. So it's a pre-sheaf F on M subanalytic is a sheaf if and only if F of the empty set is zero, and also for any U1, U2 open subanalytic, the sequence F U1 Meyer-Vietori sequence is exact. So you have just to check that you can glue a section and two open set, and you have a sheaf. Okay. You can also prove, but we shall not use it, if, moreover, the sequence with zero here is exact, then F is gamma U acyclic for any U. Okay. But it's just a remark. Okay, we shall not use it here. Okay, so we have a very easy way to construct sheaves. Okay. So my aim is to have a lot of Indsheaves, not so many. In fact, there is one which is interesting for me, for us. But okay. So here again, of course, this category mod K M S A is a Grothendieck category, contrarily to the category of ind object, okay? Because this is a general result, nothing to do with subanalytic. You have a small site, the category of sheaves, and this site is a Grothendieck category, but the inductive limit, we denote it like that, okay? It's a notation. Because it does not commute with rho.
Yeah. But this is
the
actual limit.
It's the true.
Yeah, it's a true limit here.
But because of the finiteness.
Okay, but it's since it does not commute. Okay, you worry that yeah, it's not, maybe it's not a good notation, but let's say in this talk at least, I prefer to make a distinction between limit here and limit in the usual.
So Wollaston is a stupid way to view a usual sheaf as okay.
Because right now I will have to confuse usual sheaves on subanalytic sheaves, and to make a difference with the inductive limits. Because now I take the category, what are my notation? I denote by RC KM the abelian category of R constructible sheaves. So you know what means R constructible. It means there exists a subanalytic stratification such that the sheaves are locally constant on the strata and finite dimensional. Okay, it's clear? Yeah. And in here we have the subcategory of sheaves with compact support. So there is a theorem which says the following. It says that the functor direct image, direct image, this functor is not exact, but it is exact on the category of constructible sheaves. Okay. And of course, it's fully faithful. So you can look at constructible sheaves. You can look as well as a subcategory of usual sheaves, or as a subcategory of subanalytic sheaves. Okay, so for constructible sheaves, we don't care if we are on the subanalytic topology or the classical topology. Okay. And now I define a new category, IRCKM, as the end object of the category of constructible sheaves with compact support. Okay. So, of course, I have a functor from this category of end object to the category of subanalytic sheaves, to limit with quote of fi, I associate the same thing but with different notation. If fi is a constructible sheaf with compact support, here I have its inductive limit in the category of end object. And here I have its inductive limit in the category of sheaves on the subanalytic side. Okay, so this defines this functor. Okay, on CRM, this is an equivalence. Okay, in other words, subanalytic sheaves can be viewed as the end object of the category of constructible sheaves with compact support. Okay. So you see, we have this We have unconstructible sheaves. I forget. We can look at sheaves. This was iota m. On here, I'll call this iota tilde m. On this commutes, of course. Okay. So you, and this is equivalent to mod k m subanalytic. Okay, so this is clear, but there is a danger, a trap. Okay, so you can go also, you can take this diagram also. The same diagram, this one, okay. And it will be tempting to take the direct image here. Okay, so take care because it does not commute. It has no reason to commute, and it does not commute. And this functor is not exact; it's only left exact. Okay, so when you construct an end-sheaf, for example, when you take maybe I give an example. It's time. Maybe here. Take a complex manifold X on the sheaf OX. Okay. So I can look at this at its direct image as a subanalytic sheaf on. I can look at OX as a sheaf and here I go to the end sheaves. Then I will not find the same image. And in fact, if I take the Dirac functor here, which is better because the functor is not exact, this functor is not concentrated, maybe I have to speak later of that. It's I will say that next week, but I say it already. The direct image of OX is not concentrated in degree zero. And I explain you why. Because first, what is the meaning of OX? This it means you take the Dolbo complex with infinity, okay? And I say that this Dolbo complex, if you work with a subanalytic topology, will not be exact, and it will not be exact because if you take, for example, an open set like that, the dimension of X is bigger than one, okay? The difference of two balls, an open ball minus a closed ball. Something very pseudo-concave here. Then it's pseudo-concave, and you don't have you are allowed to take only finite covering. Okay, so if you take a finite covering, the Dolbo complex will never be exact. There is nothing to do because the open set with the usual topology, you can take small balls, the Dolbo complex is exact. But here you have finite covering only, then the Dolbo complex is not exact. So this is not concentrated in degree zero. That's one reason. But if you take this functor, it's exact. And then O, as an end sheaf, is in degree zero. OK, so I will come back on this kind of problem. So what is the link? So I say it again. So subanalytic sheaves are embedded in end-sheaves, okay? Because this is nothing, because it's isomorphic to equivalent to the end object of constructible sheaves, with compact support. Okay. So what are the links between all functors that we have constructed? Okay. So you remember, we have a mod Km. Iota m, beta m, alpha m, I km, and also mod km, direct image, inverse image, rho upper shriek, lower shriek, mod km subanalytic. Okay. So when you send this here, you can see that alpha m corresponds to inverse image, and beta m corresponds to rho lower shriek. It could be, or if you want, it means that the diagram, I give one example, mod Km subanalytic, Km, mod Km. Here, for example, here if I take beta, here I take rho lower shriek, and it was called I tilde m, then it commutes, okay, and similarly with the other. Okay. Okay, so you see, okay. So we can look at subanalytic sheaves as particular case of indsheaves. Okay. So what happens with the derived category?
It is much easier to work with subanalytic sheaves.
Yeah, but for example, it's why I gave this example of O. If you look at O as a subanalytic sheaf, it's no more in degree zero. So sometimes you have no choice. We will define the O with temperate growth, then we have no choice. We cannot define it directly. But if you can define directly, it's better. So, since we work in the derived category, let's call dB I R C Km as a full subcategory, it will be triangulated, of dB, no, I forgot. Excuse me, where is it written? I. I Km. So in the this is the object F such that for any J, aj of F is in the category is subanalytic. Okay. The end object, object of the derived category of indsheaves whose cohomology is subanalytic. Okay. And it is triangulated. Okay. And so, in fact, mainly in the sequel, we will work in this category. Okay. We will work in the subcategory of indsheaves whose cohomology are subanalytic. And in this category, there is an important trick that we shall use very often. Maybe it's a proposition, or it's more or less obvious. Amorphism u from f to g in db I r c I k m is an isomorphism if and only if for any what are my notation? For any u open subanalytic om k u shifted and for any shift n u shifted by n is isomorphic to om k u n g. So to test that okay, so you remember I told you that for Indsheaves there are Indsheaves which are zero and all open sets, okay? But here we don't work with all Indsheaves but with Indsheaves which are more or less subanalytic, okay? And then you can test them on subanalytic sets, okay? And in practice it will be very important. So maybe I have time to start some examples because so the aim was to construct Indsheaves. So now I will do some analysis. I'm sorry. Not so much. So M is always a real analytic manifold. So there are classical sheaves, sinfinity or real analytic function, sinfinity function or what else, distribution on hyperfunction. That's the basic sheaves. For the analyst, it's unless infinity on distribution, but real analytic and Sato's hyperfunction are useful. So I will define what is a temperate, I don't know the in English, temperate or temperate, sinfinity function. What does it mean? Temperate infinity function. Okay, so that's the head of everything that we shall do after. So you take an open set. So you take U open subanalytic and relatively compact in M, let's say for short, on F infinity of U. So I say that F as polynomial growth. So you take a cart, a distance. So if so you take a at some point P, let's say. So you choose coordinate a local coordinate system. At P.
Point P is on the boundary of U, yeah.
Or anywhere. And you assume that there exists K compact. It's more easy intuitively. If you want to write explicit good definition, it's. But intuitively, it's obvious. A compact neighborhood of P, and there exist N and C, N integer, such that the sub for X, in after I will make a picture. So you take the distance of X to K minus u power n f of x so there is no c. Okay. So it means that f grows at the boundary less or equal to the distance, 1 over the distance to some power. Okay. F of x is the growth at the boundary is polynomial.
No, I think maybe you should assume the point of the boundary, but otherwise, regarding the boundary is empty, what is the distance to the empty set?
Oh, zero? Yeah, I was sure that you will. First, I wrote it, and after Keshua erased it. The distance, no, it's here. The distance to the empty set is zero. But maybe it's better to understand intuitively. Okay, here is the open set U. You ask that the growth of the function is polynomial with respect to the distance. Okay, that's clear, no?
No constraint on derivatives?
No, that's the beginning of the definition. It's not finished. Okay, so it's at P. You say that F has polynomial growth if the same at each p. And you say that f is temperate if all derivatives have polynomial growth. Of course. It's very intuitive. Huh? It's easier than Indsheaves. Huh? So the theorem, maybe we can attribute it to Lojasevich, but it was not formulated like that, is that u, the pre-sheaf u, so maybe I give a name. So I call C infinity T U, the subspace of function with temperate growth. Okay. So if you take the pre-sheaf U gives infinity T U, this is a sheaf on the subanalytic site. So and I will explain the proof. It's a corollary of the Lojasevich inequality. You remember that for a pre-sheaf to be a sheaf, you need to f of the empty set is zero on the sequence f u1 union u2 f u1 plus f u2 f u1 intersect u2 is exact. Then f is a sheaf on the subanalytic sheaf. Okay. So why will it be true here? Because there is something called Lojasevich inequalities. So I give it in Rn. It says that the let's say in Rn, if you take two open sets relatively compact, subanalytic, the distance of x to the complementary of the U union V is less to some there exists n such that on C, such that this is less or equal to C, the distance of x to the complementary of u plus the distance of x to the complementary of v. Okay. So something which is, if you want an example where this is not satisfied, you take something like with a with exponential here on another open set like that. Then the distance to the complementary of the union takes these two open sets. Okay. So the distance here you will have exponential on, with respect to this distance. Okay. But if the contact is of exponential type, it's not subanalytic.
So what can you tell what the open sets are in the example exactly?
Oh, you take the graph.
No. Just I didn't see the open. The thing above doesn't it drawing.
Ah, yeah. You take. This set. On this set, something like that. No, maybe, okay, I've not prepared that. Okay, so anyway, it's easy to construct two such open sets. The distance to the complementary of the union is much bigger than the distance to each open set. Okay. Here you have the distance to each, and the distance to, maybe. No, you don't. Anyway, in the subanalytic case, the distance is a depends polynomially. The distance to the complementary of the union is a polynomial with respect to each distance. Okay, and it is not true in general, of course.
Distance to the intersection of the closed set. Yeah. Complement to open its intersection of the closed
set. So more generally, I think there was an inequality concerning a function that if the function is small, then the point is close to the zero locus, and we apply it to the subanalytic function.
So if you take closed subanalytic sets, the distance to the intersection will be a polynomial of the distance to each one. Okay. Okay, so once you know that the distance to the union is a polynomial function of the distance to each one, if you know that if you have a function which belongs to C infinity temperate of U1 and in C infinity temperate of U2, then it will belong to C infinity temperate of U1 union U2 because of this inequality. Okay.
But also this temperate, can one also, if you consider derivatives, the order of growths, can one also order?
Yeah, we don't care. Yeah.
But in principle, it's possible to make them more.
Yeah, it will. But after we'll apply Dolbo, and then the derivative will be controlled. Okay. But at this level, it's not necessary. Of course, we could ask that the derivative, the distance of the derivative is one more than the distance of the function. Okay, but it's not useful here at this level. It doesn't change, okay, for what we have in mind, because of Cauchy's inequality, if you want. For a holomorphic function, we want to apply this to the holomorphic function. We want to define the temperate holomorphic function. Okay, that is the Dolbo complex of C infinity temperate. Okay, let me give another example, very simple, which follows also of Lojasevich inequality. All this, the work of Lojasevich is very old, but there is a book of Malgrange, which is old also, but not in 66, where all these things are very well explained. at the Tata Institute conference.
But did people have subanalytic at that time, or just semi-analytic?
Yeah, at this time it was semi-analytic, okay.
But then you need to know about subanalytic.
Yeah, how you guess it's it works. Yeah, of course, it's, of course. But these things are true for subanalytics. I'm not a specialist, I'm a user of subanalytic, but not a specialist, but it works. So another example is temperate distribution. So what is temperate distribution on U? So it's the image maybe we can write an exact sequence as you want. So so this is the set of distribution on U, such that, maybe let's call it S, such that S extend on to a distribution, to a section of dBm. Okay. So by duality, so in fact, we have this sequence which are exact. In fact, it's also, there is a zero also here by a good partition of unity, it's not so obvious. And also for dB. T. Yeah. There is a very, very refined partition unity theorem in Hermander. The best theorem you can imagine. And moreover, since dB t, if u is contained in v, by definition almost, dBt v to dBt u is surjective. It's like flabby, if you want. So temperate distributions are flabby in some sense, and it follows that dB t is quasi-injective. Not as a hand shift, but as a subanalytic shift. I have not defined what it means, but you can guess. Or flabby, if you want, for subanalytic shift.
But it's not soft. It's not soft, right?
Soft?
It's flabby,
yeah. I don't know.
DBT is? Flabby, or quasi injective. Let's say flabby.
So flabby means that the kind of the cohomology is zero.
Yeah. No, this is enough to have zero cohomology. But DBT is better. Because
flabby,
this,
yeah, on all subjects in the topos or something. You can define what flabby is.
Yeah, even quasi-injective in the category, it means that and the sub, in the category of subanalytic shifts, dBmt is exact. Maybe I should write SE. It will be better to write subanalytic because it's subanalytic. Is exact on the category of constructible shifts. It's not exact on all all shifts, but when you restrict to constructible shifts, it's exact. It's like quasi-injective.
The sapimorphism U and V are again, it's nice. Sub-
it's what?
U and V, not arbitrary cells, but
subanalytic, eh? Open, sub- always, eh? Always. Always. Okay, so next time I will explain the operations, inverse image, direct image, and also the dual sheaf just I will not insist, the sheaf of Whitney functions, which is dual to the sheaf of temperate function, and mainly the direct and inverse image for temperate distribution and temperate holomorphic functions. Okay, thank you.